Our call to worship is taken from Psalm 145, and I'm reading the first three verses. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. Come, come, let us sing and praise the Lord in song as we join together in singing that wonderful song, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. Good morning and welcome to our worship service today. I truly hope and trust and pray that through our service today that the Lord will touch you and that you will just respond in praise and worship and just becoming silent at the foot of the cross today. But before we continue, may I inquire, as I always do, on asking you how you are doing and are you still coping and are you still okay. I see our spring is in full swing awaiting summer, and yes, we know it's a bit dry, but you know what? The rain is on its way and God is in control. I have one announcement today, in that please take note on the 15th of October. Yes, that's the Sunday. You come to church and you stay at church, and then we're going to braai some snook. So we have a snook braai here at the church on the 15th of October. Please grab your tickets at the church office. They are 70 rand per person, and that includes your snook and patats. Now, for those of you who are English and don't understand the word patats, that is sweet potato. So that is the in thing, that we eat snook and patats. So please grab your tickets. It is going to be a wonderful day of fellowship and just enjoying one another's company with a wonderful meal to share. With that out of the way, let us do what we came to do, and that is to praise, to worship, and just become silent before Almighty God. Our first lesson today comes from Jonah chapter 3, reading only verse 10 and then going right through to chapter 4 and reading the first 11 verses. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. But to Jonah this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Jonah had gone out and sat down at a place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord God provided a leafy plant and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head, to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm which chewed the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" "It is," he said. "I am so angry, I wish I were dead." But the Lord said, "You have been concerned about this plant, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. And should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right from their left, and also so many animals?" I read only thus far. Come, let us praise the Lord. I'm not sure whether you've sung this song before, so let's say it's a new song, but it's a beautiful song, a song in which we express the strength and how great our God is. The title of the song is "Mighty to Save." Please join me as we come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty Heavenly Father, we greet you today, Lord, as we come into your company and come before your presence with singing, as we approach your eternal throne, as we are yet to proclaim that you are our God, the God of gods and the Lord of lords. Yes, Jesus, we have come to praise the triune God, and you are our Redeemer. You are the one that sacrificed your life, Lord, and went to the cross for us. And you are our Lord and our Savior. We proclaim that today. And yes, Lord Jesus, you blessed us by giving us your Holy Spirit to guide us and to keep us and to be our friend and to be with us no matter what life throws at us. So, Lord, as we gather today and as we praise you and worship you, may it be a sweet, sweet sound upon your ear, so that together with your archangels and with the whole of your creation, we can celebrate that our Lord Jesus Christ has risen from the dead and has conquered death. And he is our Redeemer and he has paid the price for us. But Lord, as we come today, we know, Lord, that we need to come clean with you, because in a week gone by, we have hurt so many people. We have not been obedient. We have not listened to you, Lord. And we need to confess our sins. So, Lord, as we come now, in our silence, we just offer you our personal and individual confessions. Hear them now, Lord. O dear Lord God, you promised us that if we do repent, you will forgive us. And Lord, we have confessed this morning. We've brought to you all the sins we've committed, Lord, and we also want to pray for those sins that we committed that we didn't even take cognizance of, Lord. Those sins, Lord, that we do as second nature. Yes, Lord, please forgive us for all our sins. And remove them from us as far as the east is from the west. But Lord, we know that you don't just forgive us. You justify us, Lord, as if we've never committed those sins ever. We praise you and we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that you went to the cross, that you could take authority over both good and bad. And therefore, it is in the name of Jesus Christ our sins are forgiven. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for going to the cross. Thank you for setting us free. Oh Lord, as we come today to this your service, we just want to pray, Lord, that you will be with each and every one of us, that you will hold us tightly, and that, yes, Lord, as we go through this service, you will open our minds and you'll open our hearts to be receptive to your word. Oh Lord, but let us not just hear it, but let us put it into practice in our lives. And Lord, as I bring your message to these your people, I pray, Lord, that you will grant me the wisdom, that you will grant me the words, so that every word and meditation that flows from my lips will be your words, Lord, and that they will bring you honor and glory at all times. So, Lord Jesus, we pray now. Be with us, hold us, and teach us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our second lesson comes from Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, and I'm reading from Philippians chapter 1, verses 21 to 30. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I'm to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet, what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you, for your progress and joy in faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one Spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. I read only thus far. May the Lord bless to us his holy word today. As we have gathered today, I truly hope and trust it is to meet with Jesus, to hear his word to us, and just to absolutely drink from him. So as we prepare ourselves for that message, let us join together in singing, "As the deer pants for the water."
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
You alone.
You
my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king.
You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than
course again, as the deer pants for the water.
To worship you.
I want to start off like I usually do every time I bring a message. And I want to ask you, have you ever heard the term my way or the highway? You heard it? Oh, I've heard it plenty of times, not so. But now I want to ask you a follow-up question on that. How many of us believe in that? Believe in my way or the highway? Now, for those of you who do not know what it means if you don't want to do it my way, then go. I don't want to mix with you. I don't want to be with you. Rather leave me alone, because I want it to be done my way. You know, there's that wonderful song, I Did It My Way. And you know what you may say to me, John, why are you talking about this again today? And I must say to you that I think it is something that is becoming more and more prevalent nowadays. And every time I speak to people, and especially in marriage counseling and in relationships, I see it as something that is inclined to break down relationships. When I sit and listen to people saying, you know, I told him or I told her to do it this way, and this way, and that way, and they or he or she just refuses to listen. Well, I want to tell you that it's not a new thing. It's been with us for very, very many years. Well, if we have a look, we all know the story of Jonah. And is Jonah not one of those? Yes, he wanted it his way. Just think of when God called him and God said to him, listen, Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh because I want you to go and tell them that they are living in sin and what they are doing is not right and that they are hurting me. Of course, God, this is who we're talking about. And how does Jonah respond? He says, no, Lord, I don't want to go there. I don't want to go and tell them. And what does he do? He runs. He flees from God. He flees and he goes the direct opposite direction that to Nineveh. And he goes to a place called Tarshish. And this is how he flees to get away from God. But you know, I don't understand how we can try and flee from God, because God, we believe and we say that God is omnipresent. So no matter where you are, God is there. The Bible describes it. It says you can go to wherever you like. And please, oh, these are my own words. God says you can never be in a place where I am not present. But when Jonah here decides not to listen to God, God teaches him a lesson. What happens? God stirs up the sea because he's in a boat with other people. And the end result is that the people cast him overboard. But God doesn't kill him. God doesn't want him to drown. The scriptures say to us that God sends a big fish. And this big fish swallows Jonah. I know a lot of you people have a problem in believing in this. But I want to ask you, how many of you have ever been to the museum down at Lieplek, just next to Saldanha Bay? And it's right, well, it actually boundaries on Veldrift. Because I went in there, and you know what they showed us? That the mouth of a blue whale can be up, when it is open, can be opened for up to 7 meters. Now, folks, I don't know if you realize how big 7 meters is. A standard ceiling in a house is 2.5 meters. So it is 3 stories high. Now think of a 3-story building. That is how big the mouth of a blue whale can open. You want to say to me it's not possible? Because I tell you, 7 meters is huge. But the Bible doesn't lie to us. And the Bible says to us, this is what happened. And what happens? This fish goes and spits Jonah out by Nineveh. And he's got to go and witness to them. He's got to go and prophesy to them and say, hey, stop what you're doing. The Lord my God has sent me and he has told me to tell you that you must stop sinning and you must turn back to him. Which brings us to today's text. Now I must tell you, I had a great struggle with this text for today in getting a message. And that is why the message that I'm bringing you is what God has given to me. Now, at first glance, I look at this and the passage starts off and it says God was happy. He saw what the Ninevites had done and they had turned from their wicked ways and they had come to obedience in God. So in other words, they listened to Jonah. But how did Jonah respond? In actual fact, Jonah was angry. And at first I could not understand why would Jonah be angry. And again, he goes in here and he's so angry. And he tells God even, God, it would be better for you to take my life. This is what Jonah says to God. And the reason he says this is because when God called him the first time to go to Nineveh, he said to God, you know what, God? You are a compassionate and gracious God. If these people turn from their ways, you are going to forgive them. And you are going to relent from the promise you made to them that you will punish them. Now, folks, this does not make sense to me. God uses Jonah to go and speak to people. And he gets angry because our God is a loving, compassionate, slow to anger, and a very forgiving God. Now, I want to stop there and pause there a little while and say, do we realize what Jonah has done here? And I've touched on this before in very many of my messages. But I've been asked a question how many times? If a person who is a person that is a great big sinner, on his deathbed, comes to repent, gives his life to Christ, is he saved? And every time I've answered and said, yes, that person is saved. And do you know the person that asked me the question, their first response is, that is unfair. Are you of the same opinion? That is unfair. Now, I want to tell you that if you are of the same opinion, then we need to look at your belief system. Remember, I said to you that we are saved by grace and grace alone. It is not what we do. It is not how good or bad we are. But it is whether we believe in Jesus or not. And very often people will compare themselves to other people in what they do. examples. Oh, you know how hard I work in the church to make sure that the services are there every Sunday. Do you know how much money I give to the Lord every Sunday by putting in the bag? Oh, do you know how I go out and how I take care of people? Oh, do you know how good I am? Do you hear? The common denominator in what I've just said is every time it goes about I. I did this. I did that. I am the one in the middle. And therefore, it is wrong. And because we have that way of thinking, we are missing the plot. We are missing out on the bigger picture. You may say to me, John, what is the bigger picture? The bigger picture is that God has given you salvation in His mercy, not because of what you are doing, not because you're a bad or a good person. Remember, I've said this many a time, Jesus came for the sinner, not for the righteous. And it is not about what you do. It's not salvation by works, but it's salvation by grace. And God calls us to love one another as we love ourselves. What does that mean? That means at every single time we must have the best interest of that person at heart. Not so? Now that person who on his deathbed finds Jesus, repents, and acknowledges Jesus as his Lord and Savior, what would be his best interest? To say that is unfair and condemn him to go to hell? Or to wish him the best that he may go to heaven? You see, the thing here is, there were a couple of you that came to the movie we showed last night, the movie on Martin Luther. And when Martin Luther is at his lowest, his church father shows him and says, Jesus, save me. I am yours. He even does that with a young boy that has committed suicide. And he says when he buries him, Jesus, save this boy because he is yours. Now, do you pray that to other people? Do you pray to Jesus to do that for other people? Because what Jonah was doing here is God responded in the manner when the Ninevites responded to God's prophecy, they turned from their wicked ways and God withdrew his destructive ways. He relented, is what the Bible says to us. Jonah responded in a totally wrong manner. Because Jonah, what did he see? God took me to Nineveh. God told me to go and warn these people. All that trouble, why? Just so that they could repent. And they did repent. And God forgave them. What a waste of time. That is the way that Jonah was thinking. But God carries on and he teaches him another lesson. Because when Jonah is cross with God because of what had happened with the Ninevites, he goes and he sits on the outskirts of the city in the sun. Now remember, this is hot. It's desert. And he makes himself a shelter, but God plants a tree, a bush, that God lets grow, and it covers this whole shelter. So, and it says that he's got shade for his head. But then again, God sends a worm. And the scriptures say that this bush shrivels up, it withers. And the next day God sends a hot scorching wind, which kills this plant completely. Again, Jonah is upset. He is angry. In actual fact, he says to God, "Yes, I am so angry. I wish I were dead." So, a quick question. So, what's Jonah worried about here? What's he caring about? He's only caring about himself. He's not caring about anything else, because God says to him, in the city of Nineveh, there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell the right from their left. And they also have so many animals. In other words, what he's saying to Jonah is, you're not worried about those people and animals. You're just sitting here to see whether I will not punish them. So you do not have their best interest at heart. And he says to him, do you think you have the right to be angry? And when he says yes, God says to him, you don't. You don't have the right to be angry. Because was it not God that brought the plant? Is it not God that put the shade over his head? So in other words, God, as he gives, God can also take away. And you know, we somehow don't seem to understand that. We do never look at the best interest of other people, because our love is superficial. Our love is not genuine, and we do not care for the best for the others. Therefore, I must ask you the question, how much do you care for God? Yeah, how much do you care for God? How much do you care for the calling he's given you? Whichever calling that may be, whichever call you have been called to do. In our other text, where Paul writes to the church in Philippi, Paul himself speaks on this thing of, I wish I were dead. How many of us don't say that? You know, I don't want to do this. This is too difficult. It will be much easier being reunited with Jesus Christ. Because I know once I'm with Jesus Christ, my labor is over. And then I just have a life of worship. Now, when we think that way, we are not thinking at the best interest of God. Because God has called you to do a specific job, and that job would be there to look out for other people, the spreading of the kingdom of God. And that is why Paul highlights it in this passage. And he says, he also would love to be reunited with Jesus Christ, but he knows that Christ has given him a job to do. And he cannot shy away from that job. So therefore, it is wrong to wish that our lives are over without considering what God wants from us. Just like Jonah. Jonah knew that God was using him. Jonah knew that God still wanted to use him. But when he didn't get his way, he wished that he was dead. Folks, I want to end off today in asking you, how serious are you about your relationship with Jesus Christ? By serving God, by serving people like God has called you, are you going to be a Jonah? Or are you going to ask yourself the question, what would Jesus do? With that pause, I give you time to think. Amen. Come, let us pray. Oh, dear Lord God, oh Lord, we have heard your word to us today, Lord. And yes, Lord, we need to admit that sometimes we are like Jonah, where we want it all our way and we don't even look at you and realizing that you are Almighty God and that your way is the right way. But rather, Lord, we will rather look at my way or the highway. And Lord, we need to beg your forgiveness for that. Oh Lord, we so often just forget about your love and forget on all your instructions, Lord, and we just look out at our own interest and doing it the way we see it. We don't even look, Lord, at the best interest of the other person, the person that we so heavily criticize, even to a point where we might even criticize you, Lord, just as Jonah did. But Lord, today we've come to say, Lord, help us to change. Help us to think differently. Help life not be about I and me, but rather about us. And me caring for other people and loving other people. And most of all, dedicating my life to you, Lord, so that I can do everything you want me to do. Oh Lord, so often I get it wrong. So often. It's all about me. So Lord, we pray that through your Holy Spirit, you will touch us, that you will convict us when we do this wrongly, and that we will wish even our worst enemies the best in their lives. Help us to love one another, Lord, like you want us to love. Help us, Lord, to see your wonderful love and your compassion, and let us strive to be just like you, Lord, and to love you and love one another and love the people, Lord, and make sure that everybody does achieve what you want them to achieve. Help us, Lord, that your word may be spread throughout this world and that your kingdom will spread, because we know, Lord, you've given us each a call, and help us to live that call the way you want us to live it. Thank you, Lord, that you are so patient with us. Thank you that the more we hurt you, it does not push you away, but you patiently sit and wait, waiting for us to return to you so that you can touch us and heal us and guide us. Thank you, Lord. We praise you and we worship you, Lord Jesus. As we come now, Lord, we pray, be with us. Guide us and show us exactly what it is that we must do. And so, Lord, we pray this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us conclude our service today by joining together in just singing together, "These Are the Days of Elijah." Folks, once again, we have come to the end of our service today, and it's been an honor and a privilege for me to share God's word with you, and thank you for listening. It truly is wonderful to know that you are out there and that you are listening to this message. So receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Have a wonderful week. I hope and trust that you will just journey with God and that He will bless you and that you will have a fantabulous week. So, until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that Jesus is only a prayer away. Goodbye for now.